Hey, Measuring Heroes. Welcome to our video blog today about new energy vehicles. We're going to explore something that, an application that we at ZEISS have been very excited about, something that is fresh and new, and something that just a trend that's coming. So, before we start talking about new energy vehicles, let's talk about the different types of vehicles there are out on the road today. We all know the ICE, internal combustion engine, or a gas engine. I personally have one. I have a 1964 Mustang. It was one of the original ones. So I personally love these old internal combustion engines out there. They've been around since Henry Ford and the Volkswagen back in the day. So these are cars that we know and love and we have had for decades now. The second one is called PHEV, or plug-in hybrid electric vehicle. You might know them as just simply hybrids. They've been around for about 20 years or so. As we move forward into the future, we have what's called a BEV, battery electric vehicle. Now, again, we already know what an ICE is. Let's talk about the difference between a plug-in hybrid electric vehicle and a battery electric vehicle. The plug-in hybrid electric vehicle is literally marriage of two different types of vehicles, right? It's both a gas engine or an internal combustion engine and an electric vehicle. So it has both a motor and an internal combustion engine and then one big gearbox which deals with the two. Historically, not all of them, but most of them will use the electric motors for the first and second gear, and then for third, fourth, fifth, and sixth, we'll switch to the internal combustion engine. Of course, the gearbox for the internal combustion engine is one big gearbox. Here's where it gets interesting, okay? The internal combustion engine will have a motor that revolves at about 6,000 to 7,000 RPM revolutions per minute. To put that into perspective, the wheels typically spin at about 800 revolutions per minute. So the power transmission or the gearbox has to basically change something revolving at about 6,000 to 7,000 to 800. The motors for the electric vehicle can revolve at about 20,000 RPM. So there's quite a bit more happening there. So what's interesting is these gearboxes need to get very, very intense. Not only does it have to switch from one motor to the next, but you have to deal with something revolving at about 20,000 RPM to about 6,000 to 7,000 RPM, both reducing it down to wheels, which are spinning at about 800 revolutions per minute. So it seems very easy that these plug-in hybrid electrics are, sure, why not, just put it in there. At the end of the day, the ability to execute that is extremely difficult because, again, to switch at these different revolutions per minute and then have the person driving not feel a jerk as it switches from one engine to the next takes a lot of quality, a lot of really good engineering, and a lot of really good measurements. Of course, we're learning that. You already know that. Here's where it gets really interesting, too, is when you go from the plug-in hybrid electric vehicle, which is the marriage of the internal combustion engine, to the straight-up electric vehicle or battery electric vehicle, what happens is these components, there tends to be less components in there. There's less of a drivetrain, less moving parts. However, because these are moving full time at 20,000 revolutions per minute, quality gets, although the quantity of the parts are less, the need for higher quality of these parts are more because, as you can imagine, if they're not made perfectly, these things moving over and over again, they'll fail awfully quick if they're not made perfectly. So we're learning that there's challenges as we move from internal combustion engine to hybrids to full electric vehicles, that the measurement needs begin to change. Now, more things change in the car as opposed to just the engine. Because Here we had a car with an engine in it. When we switched to hybrid, we stuck a battery wherever there was space in a gas engine, typically the trunk, right? But when we switched to full battery electric vehicles, you can throw the whole chassis out, right, and start from the ground. We have battery trays now, which are built into the frames. These frames used to be just welded pieces meant to keep straight and true. Now, they actually have to hold the battery. Of course, when you start talking about things like holding the battery in the frame, things like safety, these have to be waterproof, fireproof, and all sorts of everything proof. They have to be absolutely safe. So these new trays slash frames in the bottom of these vehicles become more of a measuring challenge that we never had before when we were just dealing with internal combustion engines. So the way we measure car bodies is beginning to change as we move through this to a full electric vehicle. So what tends to happen now is that because now these frames have to be measured precisely, and because quality and safety is number one for these, we have to move to 100% inspection. This taps into a megatrend, which is quality assurance is moving from the quality lab to the production floor. So we start to need to use things like machine vision to do 100% inspection. And typically using things like a CMM to do only reference checks periodically. The bulk of the measuring now is happening in line using optical techniques. Also, some of the equipment that we use is different. Because there's a battery, before some of our microscopy pieces of equipment only used to be used during the research or the development phase. Now, because we have to measure surfaces and things like that, we're using microscopy pieces of equipment in full-on production. So these are other trends that are happening that ZEISS, of course, is a part of as we begin to morph from here to there. And of course, one of many changes is the fact that there's now an electric motor, whereas before there was a gas engine, there's an electric motor. There are many things that are different about it. First of all, there are, what I didn't know before researching this, was that I thought there was a motor on every wheel. There really isn't. There's a motor for every two wheels. So if you are looking to develop a two-wheel drive car or a front-wheel drive car, you'll have one motor that will do the back wheels. If you want a full four-wheel drive car, two motors, front and back. Each of these motors has a stator in them. These stators inside of them have things called hairpins. We'll talk a little bit more about a hairpin later, but there are 100 to 400 of these hairpins in each of these stators. They're made of copper and they're very, very delicate and very, very important pieces of copper. It's what pushes the electricity through them. Here's the trick. If any of these touch, the whole thing short circuits, the whole thing's bunk. So measuring each of these hairpins is absolutely important, because if you get any one wrong, the entire motor is bunk. For now, know that as we morph from internal combustion engine through hybrid vehicles to a full electric vehicle, many things in the car are changing, not just the engine, the whole frame, and the metrology equipment that we use to measure that, it's all changing. So what's exciting about it is right now, again, we think that the internal combustion engine is reaching a plateau. And we think that even though hybrid cars or plug-in electric vehicles have been around for about 20 years, we think they'll actually ramp up a little more, maybe for the next 5 years or so, which are good for all of us because it's a conglomeration of both technologies. But at some point in the very near future, we believe that all cars will become full battery electric vehicles. And of course, we're preparing ourselves to measure whatever it takes to get that done. Okay, well, enough of my talking. This was a high-level introduction to what new energy vehicles are. As we progress through these video blogs, we'll go deeper into different applications of what we just talked about. But for now, why don't we go and have a look at a hairpin being measured in real life. Let's do it. Okay, so earlier we spoke about some of the new components in the new electric vehicles. One of those components, of course, is the motor. What we're looking at here is an application of measuring the hairpin. First, the machine we've chosen to measure the hairpin is a Prismo Verity. This allows us the opportunity to use a dot scan. There are several reasons why we need dot scan. First of all, it's very difficult to touch the part because as you touch the part, it begins to deflect, and we need perfect adherence from the measurement of the hairpin to the perfect profile part. This is done with non-contact with a dot scan. Again, non-contact, so we can measure the profile, compare it, typically about 1.5 millimeters to the perfect profile. In addition to the profile measurement of the hairpin, we have to measure the thickness of the lacquer coating to the copper. So these hairpins are made of copper, and they're coated by lacquer. If the copper touches another piece of copper, the whole stator will short out. So we put this thin coating of lacquer, which is about 40 microns worth of lacquer. And what the concern is that at these bends, the lacquer might get thin. If the lacquer is too thin and these copper wires touch, the whole stator could get shorted out and have to get thrown away. The dot scan allows us the ability to measure through the lacquer to the copper, and then measure the top of the lacquer, and then get a distance of the lacquer throughout the entire profile. So again, another reason why we've chosen the Prismo to measure this is that we can put a dot scan on the on this machine. What we're doing is we're measuring first down into the copper, and then coming back again, measuring the top of the lacquer. That's how, on this first bend and this middle bend, we're able to get the lacquer thickness. Now, again, what we're doing is we're measuring, we're traversing back and forth across the hairpin, starting from the center, which is a 3D bend, to this right side. We went back and forth. The first pass, we were measuring down into the copper, and on the second pass, then we measured the thickness of the top side of the copper. Again, the difference between the two will end up being the thickness of the lacquer. We're able to then simultaneously pick up the profile of the hairpin, and then also the thickness of the lacquer, which are the two big failure modes of these hairpins, and like I said before, cause the stator to be totally bad. There are about 100 to 300 of these hairpins in every single stator. We have to measure these every time. Typically, this setup wouldn't necessarily be 100% inspection. This would be a near line periodically to check the accuracy of whatever inline inspection system you are doing. You would need this Prismo as a reference system. But you can imagine we have to do these measurements quite a bit of time because, like I said, 100 to 400 hairpins in each stator. Each stator in each motor, and every electric vehicle will have 1 to 2 motors. And you can imagine any one of these fails, an entire motor could be bad. So it's very critical that we measure these and measure these well. This isn't technically part of the measurement, but we're using the tactile to do a base reference. In function, these would be all non-contact, because once you touch the hairpin, it will deform it and you won't be able to use the measurement. Okay, Measuring Hero, thanks for joining us this week and learning about new energy vehicles. I appreciate you joining us, and we'll see you next Thursday when we'll learn about something really cool and new. All right, see you next time, everyone.